All right, so hello everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today. I'm Chavi Chug, and I will be your moderator for this exciting session that we have planned. So I'm hoping everybody's settled in, and also if some of the attendees could, really quickly tell us if you guys can hear and see us clearly, that would be wonderful, and then we would be good to go. So you guys can drop a quick thumbs up emoji in the chat box, and we'll consider it as a green light from you guys, and you guys can hear and see us clearly. All right. Perfect. Cool. All right. So feel free to introduce yourselves in the chat box. We would love to see where everybody is joining us from. And yeah, we can move to the second slide. All right. The topic for today's webinar is AI adoption and recruitment, a look into the future of staffing with the Millionaire Recruiter. Let's quickly take a look at the agenda for the day. We'll start by painting the current AI landscape in recruitment, understanding where we stand today. Next, we'll navigate through the tangible benefits and the real challenges of integrating AI into recruitment processes. We'll then step into a live demonstration showing you how AI can be a game changer in your hiring practices. So definitely stay tuned for this one. You do not want to miss out on this one. Peeking into the crystal ball, we'll then discuss what the future holds for AI in recruitment. And finally, we'll open the floor for your questions and thoughts in an interactive Q&A session with the OG herself, Bryana, and our CEO, Sean Malapurkar. Yeah. A quick,
Hello.
yeah.
Hello,
Yeah.
boom.
A few quick intros. The webinar is powered by a Recruit CRM. We're a cloud-based ATS plus CRM software for the global recruitment and staffing industry. And we are on a mission to help recruitment businesses all over the world grow rapidly. We are thrilled to have Bryana Rooney, also known as the Millionaire Recruiter, as our speaker today. Bryana brings a wealth of knowledge and experience in recruitment, and she will be sharing her insights on the impact of AI in this field with us today. For those of you who don't know, she's a serial recruitment entrepreneur and the force behind super successful businesses like Talent Purge, Triversity, and Techies. We also have Sean Malapurkar here as the guest speaker. He is the CEO and the founder of Recruit CRM. And in less than 5 years, Sean has grown Recruit CRM to be the highest rated recruitment software across all major software review boards. So yeah, those were a couple of quick introductions I had for everyone, just to get you guys familiar with, who we have on the panel today. We've also got three exciting giveaways planned for everyone, that you would not want to miss out on. So stick till the very end of the webinar to find out what these giveaways are and also a chance to win. All right. Cool. We'll start the session with a quick poll. It should be showing up on your screens in a couple of seconds, and we will be running this poll for 60 seconds. I think everyone can see the poll now. So you guys can drop in your answers, and then we'll show you the results.
So I'm super excited to see this one. And be honest, also, like maybe you're not even using AI, at all. And maybe that's why you're all actually here, which is exciting. Are you using it to source? Are you screening, using it to screen an interview, candidate outreach, automation of admin work? I know as a recruiter, I feel like that's something I can never stand. Are you using all of it? And I don't know if there's an option. Like, what if we're not using it at all? Who knows?
Yep, we probably needed that option.
Yeah.
Because a lot of folks aren't really using it, right? Like it's just not a thing.
Yeah, it's not a thing. And you know what's really shocking to me is, I definitely know a lot of different recruiters in a lot of different aspects, whether it's internal or external. And I actually, a few months ago, wanted to run my own webinar on AI, and I wanted to have people share screens. So kind of like a similar setup to this, but I wanted to put other people on the spot, a little bit different. And I didn't get any takers. And I'm talking like cream of the crop recruiters in my network, and they were not comfortable share screening AI. And I found that to be
That's
like,
crazy.
so when you guys came in, it's like, hey, what do you want to talk about? I'm like, we have to talk about adopting AI because no one's adopting it. Like, and why not? So that's what I'm excited to talk about too.
Yep.
This is going to be fun.
All right, we've closed the poll. Let's take a quick look at the results now.
Lots of people using it for admin work and sourcing. That's
I like
good.
It, but you know, the outreach is close. Okay, I like it. Screening and interviewing, I'll talk about too. I think that that's newer, and there's a lot of human aspect to that. Yeah. So I'm excited about this. Okay.
Cool. Yeah.
Super cool.
All right. So yeah, well, that's it from me, and we can now officially get started with the session. Rana, the stage is all yours.
Awesome. Thank you. Well, welcome everyone. Thank you, Recruit CRM, for putting this on. I think this is something, you know, if you guys saw my post on LinkedIn today, to make sure we were extra jazzed about this, was it's like the words of the year. You know, it's like, why was artificial intelligence not in that, you know? But I think it kind of was, based off of, you know, like, we want to be authentic, but also we're kind of hallucinating right now. Like, those are the two things that people can really say we are going through, and that perhaps the authenticity of it is crucial right now. And I think that seeing that actually kind of gave me like what I call the money chills. And the reason being is because if people are wanting authenticity, this goes to show that hiring is always a person's job. It's always a people team. Hiring is very much, you know, it's emotional. That's something you can't really take out of it. It's anxiety filled, all of those things. You know, where do people spend most of their time at their job, right? You know, building their career, you know, it's what you're built to do. And so if people are wanting, you know, the authentic voice, then that's not necessarily something AI completely can handle, but it can enhance you, and it can kind of combat some imposter syndrome. What Sean was talking about earlier, it can accelerate your career faster. And so this is why, again, we should never be scared. Maybe my great grandkids, but never be scared of right now that AI is not taking over our jobs. But if you do not adopt AI in some form, I'm not saying you have to go all crazy, all in on this stuff, right? I think the more you use it, the more you'll feel comfortable, but it's going to make your jobs a lot easier. I think that recruiting is a very overwhelming situation, right? So we've got a great quote here. You know, recruiters who become fluent in AI and leverage the tools to free up more time for the human aspects of recruiting will continue to lead talent efforts the rest of the decade. 100%. Like, spot on. Thank you, Dr. Terry. love that finding. And feel free, by the way, in the chat, like, yeah, we're going to do some polls throughout, but put in, you know, like, you have a burning question, go for it. If, you know, you agree with what's going on, let's celebrate it. If you disagree, let's talk about that too. I mean, this is always a conversation, even though I'm kind of talking at you, but let's go to the next one. Okay, so something that I love that it's touched on in this screen is the journey of AI and in recruitment. And so it's like, we've been talking about it so much the last year and a half, I would say, but why in the world haven't we been talking about it before? You know, it's like, it's just finally getting to our industry, you know? And so there's a lot of analytics that go into this. It's like, we're starting to learn human beings' behaviors more. The trends are happening. I personally think it was kind of a COVID thing, where it was like, holy moly, our whole entire universe was shook up. And then now we're in front of, you know, really just computers all day long. We're consuming all of this social media. We're now looking at videos. Okay, so that's what's currently going on in AI right now, is that sourcing, I would say, and what we saw through the polls, super accurate, right? But sourcing is used in AI so much. And I would say people are starting to realize, okay, it can go beyond a Boolean. And how do we make the Boolean work for us? How can we do a Boolean faster? Same with screening. So this is really interesting. I'll talk about a little bit more in a bit, but screening, you know, you can have like an otter.ai stuff, anything that can essentially hook onto your interview and give you notes, translate your notes, because what we're used to, and I always call it like the kind of crank neck, but we're used to, you know, having the phone, right? Or a headset, whatever you're rolling with, and you're typing out notes. But now we're doing video, right? And so we're typing out notes still, and it's very distracting, and it's hard to be present, you know, throughout. Additionally, you know, I would say that engagement through chatbots, so the chatbots are getting lot smarter, right? Like I remember, like, you know, there's those, some of the old chatbots still exist, of course, but you know, you're like getting so angry at customer service, and we think about it, you know, it with the customer service only, but really it can have a lot of human interaction aspects to it. It's just, you have to train it. Okay. Now leveraging data analytics, it's so interesting that, you know, we're talking about this in an AI function, but there's been so much analytics in recruiting for so long. It's just, we like, that's our power. Our power is data or numbers, because, you know, as we challenge, and I know that this isn't for this webinar, but hiring managers constantly, it's hard to have those conversations. Sometimes they listen to us, sometimes not, right? But if you show them data, they have to listen to you. And so I think what's cool about that is more and more we are able to show analytics, but not just show them, but have them work for us and have them show, like, hey, this is what we're using it for. This is why we're having a conversation. This is why it makes sense. Next one. Okay, fine. I mean, this is just, again, you know, I just talked about data. This is just data, you know, and you're definitely going to be given this as well. But I think it's something to note. You know, 47% of Americans agreed that AI would do a better job than humans when it comes to evaluating job applicants. Here's the thing. Bots don't sleep, right? So if bots don't sleep, like, well, they can move faster, but they're going to go through, I mean, resumes. Think about how many resumes, how many applicants are moving, are being, like, there's like 1,000 applicants per job, right? That's a lot. First of all, who wants to do that? I know I don't. That's not the fun part of our job, right? That's actually an admin task. The human aspect is where you're hunting. But here's what's interesting. And I'm gonna kind of disagree sometimes with this, although it's 50-50, but if a human is in their right mindset, and I think you can only be in the right mindset about 30 to 45 minutes. So that's my suggestion there, is when you're going through resumes, when you're going through, you know, profiles, is really make sure that you're in it and you're going above just, hey, this person worked at Uber for 2 years. And before that, they worked at LinkedIn. You know, it's like, is that what we're looking for? Or are we looking for people that, you know, are bar raisers? And what would that mean? Well, it's their soft skills. So of course we have to start making sure that bots are looking at soft skills, not just the hard skills of things. So that's his own separate subject too. And then 63% of talent professionals say AI has changed the way recruiting is done in their organization. I mean, 100%, right? I think that should be more. I think that's really interesting. And then only 40% has actually adopted in their recruitment processes. And I think that is because we're scared. We're kind of fighting over things. There's so many tools out there. I think it's like, it's a little confusing sometimes. So I think we're going to see this number rise significantly in the next year. All right, we got another poll. What percentage of your recruitment process is currently automated by AI? So we have 0 to 25%, 26 to 50, 51 to 75, 76 to 100.
Yeah, and think of this as like how much time you consumed pre-AI and post-AI, right? So if you were spending, let's say, X number of hours sourcing, and then X number of hours talking to candidates, X number of hours doing operations, arranging interviews, and then post follow-up, how many hours of those have you been able to like squeeze through? And it's obviously different by sector.
Yeah, think of this, but, like, where do we use it? Job ads, yeah. Recruiting, yeah. Job descriptions.
Yeah. And we have a lot of fun comments on like, you know, obviously the question around, hey, 47% of Americans believe AI would do a better job than humans. The thing is, AI is able to like filter through a list, and the more you train it, it gets more accurate. Filter through a large list of data and basically tell you, okay, these 30 people look like candidates that have successfully got an X job. But recruitment is still a sales job. So you still need to talk to those people, explain the role to them, sell them the opportunity and the pros and cons outside of just comp, right? Because comp is getting more and more commoditized, multiple companies pay similar amounts of money. So you do need some salesmanship. which unfortunately AI doesn't have.
Yeah, I love that you touched on comp, because I just was talking to a company the other day, and she was like, that she's a head of TA. She was like, hey, do you have any tech recruiters that can really talk in more substance? And I was like, what are you talking about here? And she was like, well, every time I ask the question in an interview, basically the question is, why do most people decline offers? And she says, every single person is telling me comp. It's beyond comp. It's not just about comp. And the more we have pay transparency, like you said, Sean, is the more like we're not fighting comp all the time. You know, people join companies and leave companies for managers, for leaders, for the projects they work on. So many things.
Yeah. Growth opportunities, flexibility. There, and now this is sort of like a real estate agent, right? Technically, you shouldn't need one, but you do. You do need them to help you smoothen the process out.
I agree. All right, so can't wait to see this.
Ooh.
Oh, okay. Less than 25%. Very interesting. Okay. I like it.
And that also makes sense because quite a few parts of the recruitment process cannot be automated, right? Like there's certain pieces that literally cannot be automated.
And that's the fun part too, right?
That's the fun part. And at least now you don't have a bot. We don't have a bot that could negotiate compensation with people based on parameters and like have an AI like have a conversation. Not quite yet.
Yeah. So okay. So I got a tangent for a second on that one. So there's hired.com. You know, that still exists. But I will say, when they first came out, the whole thought process is they were trying to get rid of the recruiter. Okay. I feel like all of these things, it at first feels like that, although that's what they were really trying to do. And so they were trying to say, okay, engineers, you can go on this platform and you can say exactly what your price is, which I thought that was interesting. So here's my resume. Here's my price. Take it or leave it, companies. And they failed a lot, actually. They had a very hard time, and they're still not doing fantastic, but it just goes to show that negotiations, there's a skill to that. It's scary. It's hard. I get asked all the time, like, hey, can you train me to negotiate? Well, it's like, that's why, honestly, a lot of people use recruiters too, is because they want to be taken out of that process, that it's a very personal process for them. And then there's a lot of things added too. It's like, hey, what about benefits? What about work-life balance? But I mean, there's so much, right? Super interesting. Okay, so how are recruiters benefiting from AI? Again, put it in the chat too. Like, what do you love? What are you using, right? Yes, we've already talked about the sourcing, the screening, the assessment. The assessments are very interesting. Bias, human bias mitigation. This is definitely almost another webinar, to be very honest, because there is controversy here. But here's the thing, is that of course bots have bias because humans have bias. But can we train a bot to have less bias than a human? Yeah, we can. You know, you got to think that your bias is from when you were a baby, essentially. It grows internally. It grows where you live and all of those who you're with, all of those things. So you can train a bot. As far as bias goes, data-driven decision-making. You could literally say, hey, here's the templates and sequences I'm using, and here's which ones are working better. Here's what subject line is working better, you know, stuff like that. Faster, more efficient workflow. Oh my gosh. I mean, I'm sure we're all pretty happy that Calendly exists, right? Like, hey, I don't have to go back and forth on when rescheduling interviews. Here's my link, right? And then therefore an enhanced candidate experience, which also, you know, really can come with surveys. But you're thinking, how is there AI in surveys? Well, you can have your whole process lined up, which includes the moment, like let's just say the candidate's interview is over at 3 p.m. today, well, at 3:05, they can automatically be sent, you know, a survey. So all of these automations are just killer. They're great. Okay, so matching and sourcing. Now, here's something I will say, and I know that we'll touch on a little bit later, but in the world of AI, what's more and more important is that candidates and recruiters alike realize the power of SEO and the power of words. Okay. So as we're having bots going through and matching, using these algorithms to essentially, again, shortlist top talent here, what you see on the screen, it's like they still had to have that on there. So how are we making it smarter to maybe not only rely on everything that they say, again, going beyond the Boolean. So this is can reduce the top of funnel, you know, significantly. This is what's great. I mean, now trust me, I like it like the next person going through LinkedIn page 1 to 40, right? But we don't have time for that. That's a lot. That's heavy. Using all of predictive things. So again, I go back to the templates. So Kate, we can probably go through these slides a little bit faster because I already kind of did that. But yeah, so if you have to A/B test things. So you can like one day say, hey, I've got this great message, but is it this great message? What about another? Let's try something else. Maybe let's try something shorter. So we're going to run those things. I'm also going to look at, and there's so many capabilities here. I'm going to look at, hey, do people get back to me more on Monday or Tuesday? Do people get back to me more in the morning, the afternoon, or the evening? So, and then therefore I can schedule things out according to my success. And I think that's what's really important. Now, video interviewing platforms with AI, there is a lot being built here. I also use this in my business development. I know, like, you know, we have on agency and so internal and external, you know, recruiters, and biz dev is definitely something that I feel like is the hardest for agencies. And so using a video is amazing. There's transcripts, there's tons of AI capabilities there. But in addition to screening candidates, so something that is coming, that's not here yet, but we'll probably be here more in like June next year. But it is a soft skills of video interview bot, which is incredible. And it's taking the your social cues, your heart, like how's the heart beating, like the flicks of your eyes, you know, stuff like that. So there's a lot of things that go into that. Are you looking at the camera? Do you have that? So very interesting. Same with admin tasks, which I think I'm going to let Sean handle because he's the expert here. Trust me, I would love to build an ATS, but they already built a really great one. But there's a lot of admin tasks that, you know, your ATS CRM can definitely handle for sure. And that's the exciting part.
And that's the part where we see there's most value that can be quickly added without a lot of technical training. Literally anyone who's very little understanding of how tech works, someone who's basically just writing emails today, can come in, and because of how GPT has basically brought this technology in the hands of every single person, give a normal, very non-technical person the ability to leverage AI to help you draft better emails, clean up your notes, and basically reduce anywhere from 20, 30 minutes to an hour plus of admin time every single day. Literally anyone can do this with like 30 minutes of training.
Mm-hmm. I love that. And I love that. So I use ChatGPT a lot, which I'll share screen in a little bit, but you mean you can even get rid of the filler words, right? Like everyone has filler words. The hey, how are you? I hope you're having a great day. That's a filler sentence. All right. Do you believe is the biggest benefit of AI in recruitment? Right now, I think as we're adopting it, as we're learning about it, there's going to be debates on this, right? And I think until you actually start to use it and try it, but give it enough adoption time, you know, you might change throughout. Who knows? That's the fun part. So recruit CRM team, what would be great? Let's keep this data and let's roll this out another 6 months and see what people say. That'd be super interesting.
Hell yeah.
Mm-hmm. Also, another thing to think about is what are we fearing? What are we fearing with AI? Now, again, we talked about like the bigger aspect, oh my gosh, it's going to replace us, because I think we saw layoffs at the same exact time that AI really started to come through our inbox. And again, it's been around for a long time. I just think that that's where the biggest push was, because the leaner you have to run, the more we have to care about bots, about AI. And that's how it's like, okay, I now know how to run a really lean team, and like, let's not make all these, you know, let's not overhire again. I think that's what's really important.
Yeah. And it's not as, you know, I think everyone freaks out about, hey, is AI going to take our jobs? Every time there's a technological shift, there's jobs that change, right? There's new old jobs that die and new jobs that are created. When computers came out, we stopped having people who were typists doing typewriter work. But then we have this whole new industry of knowledge workers that are working on the computer and on the internet and basically making significant amounts of money making a great living doing today with internet doing remote work. So the fear, people shouldn't go in and start like fear mongering around, oh, now AI is going to take our jobs. Just like 30 years ago, people were like, computers are going to take our jobs. And then, and every time, right? Like when cars came out, people were like, oh, dude, you know, no more jobs for people like growing or grooming horses or whatever, right? In stables. That's simply not true. New jobs are created every time there's a shift in technology. And the key is, how do we drive productivity up? The more we can drive productivity up, the more income we can produce. There's more leisure or free time that can be produced. Back in the day, people work 7 days a week. Now people work five, in some places 4 days a week. And that's possible because there's more productivity leveraging technology. And it's layer upon layer of technology. It's incremental, but it really adds up over time.
Mm-hmm. Like it. Okay, reducing time to hire, enhancing candidate experience. That's interesting. Data-driven decision making, migrating human bias. Okay. I think for me it would be a no-brainer to reduce the time of hire. For sure. Enhancing candidate experience, I still think there's a lot to go here, but it's also because I think there's a debate on what is candidate experience. I mean, we can really, again, a different kind of a subject, because I actually think it does enhance candidate experience if you use it to save time, which is really, again, taking the admin out and giving them that human interaction and really having conversations with them after the interview, walking them through things, walking them through motivators. Like, you have more time to do that stuff. And then also to have the follow-ups that you need, which again, doesn't always have to be manual. Okay. Is it a double-edged sword? Next slide. Let's look at this. All right. Advantages of integrating AI in recruitment. And so again, there's goods and bads of everything, right? But 4% average increase in employee revenue results from implementing AI in recruitment. Again, and we're going to see something go higher there, right? Hiring cost reduction per hire is attainable. Yes, recruiters turn to AI for more efficient time management and hiring. I mean, again, all great things of data. All right, top recruiting outcomes hiring pros hope to see from generative AI. Faster, engage candidates faster. I mean, again, if you're looking at the screen, it's like faster, easier. It's like rinse, repeat. I mean, yeah, of course, everything we do every day, it's like, essentially, if you want to dissect what recruiting is, it's the same thing every day. But as recruiters, we know every single second is different. Every client's different. Every candidate's different. So for example, when someone gets back to me on an email, I can actually have it. I can send exactly what I want, because I already know that, hey, this is what I'm sourcing for. Let's just say Meta, right? Meta's my client. I already know what most people get back at. They want to know a little more detail. Here it is. It's already ready to go. Another one. Okay, great. I need your resume. Let's set up a time. Here's my Calendly link. And it's like all these things, again, can just be automated, and you don't have to keep typing it all out every single time. That's like, it's silly. All right, so here's the not rosy stuff. So bias and algorithms, yes. So over 33% of job candidates will automatically be disqualified by AI-driven recruiting processes due to potential bias. Privacy issues, resistance to change among staff. Everything on here, though, you can say about so many things. I mean, how many hacks have we had, right? Like, we're always scared of someone having our data. Privacy, for sure, right? We're always thinking like, hey, who's watching on my phone, right? But here's what's interesting is that, like, when you say potential bias in disqualifying candidates, it's like, well, we would do that anyways. So for example, like if I have a company that only wants top computer science degrees, I'm already putting bias into my search. That's already a bias, you know? So like, we have to think about that stuff and not perhaps think that, oh, it's the bot that did it. It's actually us that did it. You know, we just have to teach them to know better and do better. Okay, that very interesting. 66% of job seekers in the US say they will not apply for a job that uses AI to make hiring decisions, as they feel it lacks the human touch. I want to fight this one as well. I mean, again, research is research, data is data, but I think that we have to adopt, that job seekers have to adopt. If we're adopting this in a hiring process and recruiting processes, naturally they have to as well. Otherwise they can make that decision to not work for that company, but it's up to the company in order to have the human touch at different parts of the process in order to not have this fully automated. I mean, I can't tell you how many times with a chat bot, I'm like, customer service, or you're on your phone, customers are like, want to talk to a person, you know? So I think we definitely, you know, yearn for human connection, but you can put it in, you know, your AI processes and stuff. And again, that's why admin work, taking that out is crucial. So you have more time, more human touch. Again, like a lot of times when we're going through, you know, resumes and there's so many people that you have to get back to, think about how many times do people talk about being ghosted? Okay. It's like all over our LinkedIn feed, like a lot, right? Oh, this recruiter ghosted me. This company hasn't gotten back to me. It's been weeks. Well, if we put more AI into processes, guess what? You probably wouldn't be ghosted like this. It's just like, they don't think about how much work we have to do and how time consuming it all is.
If you're getting ghosted, it's the bot getting ghosted and not you, right?
Right.
So the bot is sending messages and no one is responding to it.
100%.
But to go through some of these just discussion points, right? And we've put these on the board just to have sort of anchor points to think about. So, you know, the first one's like, what do we think about the role of AI in the recruiting process, right? Like, and Brianna has a perspective from someone doing recruiting. I sort of have a slightly different perspective from someone actually selling recruitment technology. But the fact of the matter is, literally 12 months ago, if I talked to any agency recruiter, they would, and I asked them, hey, how do you use AI? They'd say, what's that? That would be the default answer, right? So AI hasn't evolved over time. It didn't really exist for day-to-day recruiters, right? And the only reason it has come into play is because of this whole commercialization or consumerization of these enterprise AI tools that are now available to everyday people. Right, with Bard, with GPT from OpenAI. So these are literally new models that are available to regular consumers, right? Till this point, as recently as 12 or 14 months ago, a normal person running a 5-person company or 20-person company couldn't really use any AI unless they hired of AI, you know, natural language, NLP engineer or machine learning engineer, and then bought a huge data set and got them to train that data set. And even then the result would be pretty mediocre. So it's you know, AI, the role of AI hasn't evolved. The AI has just come in. And the question is, what parts of your business do you use AI on? Because if you try to, like, if you go into this thinking, hey, there's a thing called AI and I'm going to implement it in my business and it's going to make it 10x better, that's not how it works, right? You have to figure out how you can use these new tools that are available to you to make work 5, 10, 20% more efficient for different members on your team. That's how you get started on it. And then you make incremental progress. This isn't a all or nothing play. And Brianna can maybe give a little bit on it.
Yeah, no, I love that. I think about all the things, I mean, just in the last couple of years that has made things faster for me and my team. I mean, content, even. I think, you know, again, we're in a different world right now where it's like content is giving people a lot of organic traffic, whether it's candidates or clients. I mean, it's massive. Branding and marketing and recruiting is massive. Okay. Now we have Canva. Like, I feel like this really professional designer at this point with Canva, you know, same with, again, when I talked about with Loom. And then with ChatGPT, I want to write an article. I want to be present. I want to, you know, be in the conversation. I want people to think of me when they need a tech recruiter. You know, that alone, I think has, you know, 10x I've seen value from. So I think that there's even those things that, yes, it takes less time for me to do, but the ROI on it also is pretty massive. Now, when we talk about what areas of recruitment has AI provided the most value, well, I just kind of went over that, but I would really say sourcing, and one, doing that faster, I think is important, but also being inspired on where am I sourcing and how am I doing it? I think that's provided significant value. And I think what's really interesting, especially for up and coming or people that want to start their own agency, going back to the branding and marketing aspect of things, before that stuff used to be really overwhelming. How do you have a voice? How do you show who you are? Because again, that's not just for agency owners. That's for like, do candidates want to work with you? Is your response rate high? Sometimes it's about your message, sometimes it's not. But if it's about the message, you're not getting the message right. Guess what? We got AI assistants for that too. You know, we have the ChatGPTs of the world. And then additionally, what are some unexpected outcomes recruiters can experience with AI adoption? And so I'm going to go into the negative because I think we're going to talk about tons of positives, right? But we also have to, the double-edged sword that we were going over is technology, which Sean was talking about earlier, is yes, is it moving a little faster? Absolutely. It's finally here, right? And we can navigate things easier, but there are a lot of bugs. AI gets it wrong a good amount of time. So that's again why the human aspect of things and us training things is really important. But if you're going to use something, if you're going to use AI and think it's going to solve all your problems, you're going to get very frustrated very quickly, which is why the adoption rate is so small. Is because it didn't work for me the first time.
Yeah. And there's also things, and this is what most people don't think of, because you know most people do a broad stroke saying that I'm going to put AI into everything, and I'm probably going to be parroting this over and over again. There's certain things AI does extraordinarily well, right? Take a paragraph and tell AI to break it down to make it sound smoother, nicer, more polite, less polite, fix grammatical errors, write a job description off of information we have, format it. It does that admin / back office assistant job, the sort of jobs that, you know, most businesses in the West were traditionally outsourcing to places like the Philippines and India. A lot of those jobs can be automated, right? Because they're basically back office operations. What cannot be automated, or what AI is not as good at least today, is someone coming in and saying, hey, I want to be able to give you a job description, and I want you to give me 10 candidates from the internet that would be a great fit with their phone numbers, and actually dial them automatically with a script, and then hopefully they just accept the job, do an interview. And so that part of the job, right, unfortunately, is much, much, much harder for AI to do for you, at least today, with the technology that's commercially available in the market. And that's something that will still need you to be a great recruiter, a great salesperson, a great communicator. But what we want to do is we want to remove all of this admin lag that great communicators and recruiters, who are basically great salespeople, had to carry by automating it. We want you to go in and use any tool. It doesn't have to be Recruit CRM. I know we're sponsoring this webinar, but it can be any tool that implements basic AI tools, basic GPT, basic Bard, and essentially get more productivity out of boring stuff, writing emails, writing messages, taking notes, transcribing your calls, so on and so forth. And to some of the folks that are asking questions on the chat, yes, we'll be covering what Recruit CRM is already doing in terms of AI and what's available today. And we'll also be giving you a quick insight into what we will be working to make available over the next 6 to 12 months. Rihanna.
Exciting. Okay. So I think I get to demo now, right? Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. All right, fine. So today what I'm going to demo, I'm going to share screen a few things. Some I already have kind of ready to go just because of time. You know, it's like to watch me go through all of it is insanely time consuming. For this moment, but some things I will just do off the cusp, and some other things I just put in a demo account so you can see from start to finish. I do really like, I love running lean. I would say a lot of the reason why I feel like I'm successful is because I learned scrappy ways to do things. And then now I'm learning, ooh, what tools can I use at either for free or with minimal cost? I think that's really great. And then once you also, you know, maybe hit a certain amount of revenue or you have a different budget internally, yeah, you can really go for it. And so I think this is the fun part. So here comes my share screen. All right. Kate, I think you got to stop sharing. Okay, cool. Okay, so you guys can see this, right? I am going to start with Cubby Scout. So now I'm starting with the expensive, and I'll get to the free. Okay. This is something that I use a lot. Covey is a wonderful tool for sequencing, for sure. It's kind of like a gem, but they moved on from that. You know, yes, do they have those capabilities? Sure. There's a lot of companies that do that. But this is a outbound and inbound bot. So for example, I have a CFO search. This one's really difficult. So what I would do is I would go over here to my outbound intake. I just want to make sure we can all see this, right? We're good. Okay.
Yep.
So we have basic features, right? But that we're going to load in the job description. The bot's going to look at it and see like, hey, this is probably what's important and whatnot. But it's more of like, how do I get into the mind of a sourcer? And I will tell you, if there was one job that I would pick, I would do over and over and over again, because I love so much, it is sourcing. That's why it's kind of crazy that I use this tool, but it's because I get to still use what's going on up here in order to put this in. So here's like a hiring manager evaluation signal. So there's a lot of things that you can do all of this manually. Okay, but it's going to take you a really long time to do it. So in this particular CFO search, I needed to make sure that it was capitalized heavy companies, someone that has experience at a company that went from R&D to production. Now here's the industries. Here's why this would take me a long time to do: farming, solar, semiconductor, manufacturing plants. You got to go grab all of those companies, right? Experience getting funding. That's important, but also at a manufacturing plant. Has experience taking a company through IPO. I would have to find who went IPO in the last whatever years and make sure that same candidate was there during that time. Has experience with strategic finance. And you know, this goes on and on, right? Doesn't have food or beverage, whatever I want. So then I'm going to go back here because I'm just a demo, but I'm going to show you what that bot looks like. I'm going to run the bot. And so I already know that it can't be a previous employee. So there's some things that it's going to test, not hiring the last 3 months, just stuff like that. Currently working in finance or as a CFO, currently SVP or C-level seniority in the US, in the Bay Area. So I can go throughout all of this stuff and the bot puts us all in. Okay. So now let's just say, here's who I want to bring in. I see Michael here. I see that he might be a good fit, but let's validate it. So we're essentially testing the bot. And so it goes through and it checks everything that you're essentially working for, matched everything. Now, what this bot does is it sends them messages, and it does that in sequence form. So I can also show you how I do my sequences as well, but it's going to go through and send the sequences. And what's going to happen is the bot's running for me, it's sourcing for me. And then it's also sending the messages for me. And then when they're interested, it gets in my inbox. And now here's my time to shine. I'm going to call Michael and we're going to have a really in-depth conversation. And instead of just having like 10 to 15 minutes to spend with him, I might even spend up to 45 minutes. It's a C-level, you know? I'm going to have extra time to make sure I know how this company goes. I have the extra time to talk to the hiring manager. Those are all the great things. Okay, so here's another thing. So I'm on ChatGPT right now. Okay, boy, do I spend a lot of time here. On the free version, you know, do we have also a paid version? Yes, some for marketing, but it's very minimal. Okay, so as if you guys saw my post today, I talked about, hey, I want to make an exciting LinkedIn post about this authentic word of the year. So what I did was, hey, could I have done a better post? You know, maybe I should have used this before, but I put in what my post was and I wanted to say, hey, I want to make sure that this is really captivating and it's used for LinkedIn. So ChatGPT gives me this great with emojis. It's fun. It's visually appealing. It's hitting all the right things. You know, of course, if I wanted it, you know, shorter, more in depth, sure, could I do that? But no, they actually did a really good job. But now I use Grammarly a lot. So now I'm going to be like, you know what? Is this in my voice? Did I do a great job? So I copied and paste. Here I am in here. Now let me make this a little bit bigger for y'all. Okay. So now I'm in here and I use Grammarly. I mean, for sure, if you are not using it, it's amazing. Again, they have free versions, and actually that's the one I totally recommend. You're fine, unless you're doing tons of writing. But you can even captivate how you want your voice. So Sean was talking about that. You know, I want casual, personable, engaging, but maybe I want direct, you know? So if maybe I'm doing direct with candidates, but not with my content. I could do that. You put in your profession. Love that. Okay. So now I want to use that voice. Now I'm going to identify gaps. So what is the connection between the two words, authentic and hallucinate, being crowded words of crowned words of the year? What's the connection? So Grammarly is telling me that I didn't, or that this message didn't do a great job of putting those things together. So now I'm going to read it. And this is where the human brain comes in. And this is your own genius. Now I'm going to look at it and think, oh, could I have done better? Or do I want to go back to ChatGPT and tell it to do better? Who knows, right? Give me ideas for improvement. Oh my gosh, if you guys aren't using this, I love this. I love this. So now it gives me all of these different ideas on how I could do better. Awesome. And then pick out my main point. Now, I love this. Now, not necessarily for all content, right? I'm not spending tons of time doing this for content sometimes, but maybe I want to use this for my messaging to candidates or my biz dev messages. I'm going to pick out here and I'm going to say, hey, did this pick out my main point? And if it says promoting a webinar event, yeah, that's actually what I was trying to accomplish. So I nailed it, moving on, and I'm posting this. I think that's what's really important to think about. So same with, hey, am I sending a message to a client and am I like beating around the bush? So Grammarly is actually going to tell you, you know, did you actually point out the main point? I love this. Okay. So now I want to show you something. Love this. All right. And this is, again, just like a kind of a dummy account. Drippify. So we talk about sequences a lot. I love sequences. That's probably my most favorite thing, because people have to see, and there's tons of data on this, people have to see you 4 to 6 times, your name, you have to come out, right? And so you can do all of those things very manually on LinkedIn. So let's just say you see a LinkedIn post and, oh my gosh, I really want to work with Pinterest. That's my dream company. I want to work with Pinterest. I'm going to follow them on LinkedIn. I'm going to reply to their post. So now they're seeing me. I'm going to add them on as connections, the TA team. I'm going to do all those things, right? All very manual. Or does it have to be? So Drippify and also Wallaxy, two great things that I would use for LinkedIn sequences. Now, here's how we would do it. You get to add leads. And so let's just say my search is going to be staff software engineer. That's my search. Okay. Now I already have this loaded just for time. So now what I did is I went to my LinkedIn recruiter. And I put in my search and I put, I'm looking for San Francisco. I'm looking for a staff software engineer. And I only want people who are at companies with less than 50 people. So what am I going to do up here? I'm going to copy this here and I'm going to go in and it's going to create a list for me. And then you're going to see how it works. But let's just say, hey, it can grab up to 1,000, but for time, let's just say, let's grab 100. Okay, so now we're going to go next. And then this helps you with your sequences, okay? But I want to do lead gen. I can select a template, right? Of course, you can make your own template. But here's how it works. And here's the cool thing is so it sends an invite. So this is definitely for this particular one is for people that you are not connected to. It sends them an invite. And then you can say, okay, great. I want this to happen in 5 days. Once they're accepted within an hour, I want to endorse skills. Now, I personally wouldn't, this is not my favorite tree here. I don't think that that's that important to endorse someone's skills, just a quick note. But I would just send them a message. So I would get rid of this right here. You can remove it. Yes, I want to remove. Okay. And so you can play with it. And again, I'm not going to play with it right here, but you can play with it however you want. And I think this is what's really great. And so once they accept it, then you can add all of these actions. Message, follow, like a post. Remember I just said, you want to like a post? This is pretty cool. And this does a lot of things for you. And your activity level on LinkedIn can go up drastically, which again, LinkedIn likes. LinkedIn likes when you're active. And so are they going to push your message forward a little bit more? Maybe. And so this is how it would work. And then you can end the sequence with however many, whatever you want, the times, all of those things. That's how sequences work. Okay, that was fun. Another great thing that I like to do is via Loom. So when I am doing biz dev, and sometimes when I'm doing outreach, but I would say this is mostly like a biz dev thing. I want more clients, or maybe I want to just talk to a hiring manager really quickly and I want to get my point across. So this is just a quick video I did. What's cool is, of course, you can speed things up and they can listen to you very fast. But what's cool over here is you can get Loom AI. And so you can have the titles, different chapters. It's a little more digestible for me because I do such short videos with this. I don't need it. But what I like is I can add my Calendly link right here. So how cool is that? Now I'm sending a video, they're understanding and they're getting a grasp of who I am and what I solve or what I'm talking about. And then I said, hey, great, go ahead and schedule something with me. And so now here they are on my calendar. That's really great. I love the transcript of things. I think that's really cool. They can comment in here, all of that stuff. Again, you can add a summary, which it just completely does for you. This I love. Okay. Do we have any questions, Sean? I know what's crazy is we're already coming up on time. Sean, yeah, did you want to pop in here? Yeah.
Yeah. No. So this is great on the sourcing bit and really like it. And we're obviously going to show some stuff in like a few seconds about the kinds of stuff you can do post sourcing on Recruit Serum with AI, and just in terms of reducing admin work. So if you're sort of done with your bit, I'll take over for a second.
For time, let's definitely do that for sure. Let me stop my share.
Yeah, guys, and again, I'm gonna do a screen share, and I'm gonna spend 10 seconds just explaining one thing, right? AI as a feature set, or right, literally a class of product, has really come into recruitment over the last 12 months. At Recruit CRM, we've tried to implement as much of it as possible in the last literally 4, 5, 6 months. And there's a lot more to come over the next 12 months. So I'm going to start by talking about the couple things we as a company have focused on for our users. We're all recruiting agencies. And what we're also planning to do. At an overarching level, there's like three or four things that matter, right? The first bit is GPT. I think this is sort of like the King Kong with the 200-pound gorilla in like the AI game. And we've tried to figure out what are the different ways we can leverage the technology that GPT has built, or OpenAI has built within GPT, spending billions and billions of dollars, and basically just give it to our customers for free and help them gain value. The couple other things we've been working on for the longest time is a partnership with TextKernel that does AI parsing and then matching, which is also constantly being improved. And the third bit is less AI, but is very linked into AI, which is automation and integrations, and how we can give enterprise-grade automations and integrations to basically SMB businesses that have just started out a couple of months ago. And this sort of feeds back into the AI piece, because you can source using AI, but then you need to do a lot of automation to connect to the other tools you're using and just to set up cadences and sequences and automation. So let's start with a very simple workflow, right? You find somebody on LinkedIn. Now I found myself. I go in, I think I'm interesting, and I save myself. And then I say, I want to view myself in the database, right? I want to view this candidate in the database. I go to that candidate's profile. Now, because we've been able to parse using a tool like TextKernel, we're able to reduce all of this data entry around adding someone's work history and education history, because that's just automatically pulled in, right? University, school, all the jobs this person has had, descriptions of the jobs. And again, this works as long as someone has a resume or a document or a LinkedIn profile. It does the same thing. The second thing is outreach and communication, right? How do we automate outreach? How do you go from clicking someone's email, and this is true on any ATS system, and typing a message or using a template one of your colleagues has created, to just speeding this up, right? Because the problem with templates is sometimes you don't want to use a template, but then if you have to start from scratch and you have to say hi, it's a blank page, and you have like this creative dilemma of like just sitting in front of the screen. And one of the simplest ways to solve it, right, is using GPT. Just tell GPT, hey, write an email to convince Sean to join the company to do an X role. And then the system just writes an email for you. And it has the context you need it to have, right? the key here is this is useful irrespective of whether you've just started in recruitment a week ago or you've been around for 10 years. Because a lot of the messaging you write is the same. The question then is, how do you tweak this raw draft that's being created by GPT to give it your own personal touch, right? Which dramatically reduces the amount of time you might take to write a new email from 5, 10, 12 minutes to a couple of minutes, right? And that done 20, 30 times a day does save a lot of time. The next bit is obviously, you know, Brianna talked a lot about automations and sequences. We've also spent a lot of time and effort building sequencing into Recruit CRM. But what we realized was candidates and clients both don't respond very well to pure play email sequences because they know that this is automated. When they receive an email from you at more or less the same time, every third day or second day, every week for 3 weeks, they know, hey, this is a bot sending me messages. And so what we tried to do was we said, hey, can we combine these automated emails with to-dos or tasks where the emails are still being sent by the machine based on your instructions of send 5 emails, but in the middle add a task in where you have to actually pick up the phone and make a phone call or personally send somebody a message on WhatsApp or text message. And the moment you do that, what happens in the other person's brain is they imagine all of the other automated steps are also manually done. Because they see an automated email, and then a real phone call, and then an automated email, and they suddenly assume everything is real now. And that's really, really important. The next piece, and I think we had this on the chat as well, is around CVs, right? How do you create completely new CVs? Now, we've tried to combine AI with our own proprietary technology of like creating new templates. So, and I'm just going to give you guys a quick glance at this. I can go here in here and I can say, AI, can you tell me who Sean is? And, you know, the AI writes like a quick description. Sean has 9 years of work ethic. Sean has blah, blah, blah. I can now talk to it and say, make it pretty. And then hopefully it makes it a little prettier to read, right? It's broken it down. It's making it cleaner. I can now take some of this text and I can say, okay, insert this in. But I also have my own template. Every brand or company has their own template. So I go in and I say, use Sean's template, which is this little template thing that has like a random logo, has some fields of information, has the AI generated text at the bottom. And I also really care about work history. So I want you to add like Sean's work history and I want you to add his last 3 jobs, right? So I've created this literal custom block. And the only thing we care about is his title, his start date, end date, and maybe location and description. And what we're able to do now is with a combination of the text generated from GPT, the combination of the AI parsing that's being done by TextKernel and our own tech around building CVs, we're able to essentially create a new CV. Now this, I just created this right off the bat. You can obviously format it and template it to be better. But the key is we're able to create completely new resumes in literally 2, 3, 5 seconds by clicking on a dropdown. And you can download this, you can send this to clients. You can put this in a brochure with like 10 other CVs together. And you can do the same thing in many other places. You can be writing notes. You can be, I love how it starts with he's a nice guy. I don't know if I wrote it or one of my colleagues wrote it, but you go in and you can have templates to write notes. And then you can actually tell AI, hey, can you extract key points from the note I just wrote? And the objective of AI here isn't to do your job for you, but to make your job easier. If you're already thinking certain things and scribbling stuff down, can we use AI to like arrange it in a cleaner format so you're not spending time hitting backspace and enter 3 times to space things out? Another piece where we've really used AI and we've used it aggressively is around call transcription. And this is something very common in recruitment. If you know any recruiter worth their salt is spending 1 hour, 2 or 3 or even 4 hours a day on the phone talking to candidates and clients. And what we built out was we were like, hey, what if we could not only record the audio of a call, but create a minute-by-minute transcription of everything spoken about on a phone call, but then take that minute-by-minute transcription and basically just extract the key points. And we've done that. So now you're able to take a 24-minute call here and condense this into basically 10 sentences that a human can read in 20 seconds versus playing back 24 minutes of audio or spending 3 minutes going through a transcript that's honestly not simple to read, right? Because it's ugly. Now this is some of the stuff. On the flip side, on the recruiting side, every time you get a new job from a client and the client says, hey, I don't have a job description, write one. With GPT embedded, and now this is true for Recruit CRM, but it's also true for maybe a bunch of other SaaS products that compete with us, right? So I'm not trying to say we're the only ones that do this, but you have, as recruiters, you have to use these tools where you say, hey, AI, can you just write a job description for me? Or the AI is basically writing a job description for what this person's going to do based on the details it already has about the company, about the job title, about the salary range. And this just helped because you're able to now start with drafts versus blank pages. Now, to go one step further beyond like emails and sequences and AI to complete tasks for you, like sending emails and doing tasks, the other big thing we're really going to talk about today is a partnership we just released. This isn't even live. We only have 9 of our 1,300 customers using this at this point. It's an integration with a platform called Workato, which is basically an automation platform. And they have steps in the middle where you could add AI and you could have GPT do things for you. But essentially, think of this as an enterprise-grade Zapier that gives you more power, right? You can create calculations. You can do a lot of additional things that are not possible in a basic Zap. And you're able to do this within Recruit CRM. So you can literally go into Recruit CRM, you can go into settings, and we literally have a section called Workflow Automations, where you can say, I want to connect Recruit CRM to another app, or you can connect two completely different apps to each other without even having Recruit CRM in the workflow. We're basically trying to give our customers an automation platform that allows them to connect Recruit CRM to other applications they use, or just other applications they're using to each other. And if you're a 3, 5, or 10 person team that doesn't quite have the internal capability yet, you don't have someone full time who can like figure this out for you, we actually have free support and humans on our team that specialize in just doing this, that'll do a half an hour call with you and then set these automations up for you, right? And then those could be journeys around, hey, every time we have someone fill a Google form, it creates a row on Google Sheet. Check if that candidate exists or that job exists in Recruit CRM, create the job, notify our team on Slack. Literally automations like these that we could craft within the platform. That's sort of it, Brianna.
Yeah, all right.
Nice.
We quickly pause for a short poll. So yeah, we're dropping a quick poll in the chat for everyone to get a quick feeler of how you've been enjoying the webinar so far. So please do take the poll. And let us know. This will help us curate even better and more power-packed webinars for you in the future. So yeah.
And Chavi, we are over time at this point. You want to do a part two? Do we want to what are you wanting?
Yeah, we'll take around 10 to 15 more minutes for the Q&A section. And okay. Yeah, I think we can wrap it up after that. Yeah,
that's what I was thinking, because I think the Q&As are so important. It's like we could spend all day talking about AI and the different ways that we use it. Yep. And Shani did such a great job. I love that. I love how just everything connects. Like the Zapier thing is always my favorite. Things connecting to Slack that connects to my calendar, all that stuff. But I think, definitely taking that moment for people who did show up to get their questions answered would be great.
Yes, and we have so many interesting questions from the audience. We'll try to answer as many as possible. But yeah, we've collected a few good ones.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Perfect. Even let us know too, like we do these things to help, right? And so it's like, if you want certain things, please let us know and we can really get hyper focus on this. It's a massive topic. All right, a little mixed. Overwhelmed. Yep, I could see that. A lot of things moving.
All right. And it is a lot of information, but the key, guys, here is irrespective of whether you're starting a new recruiting business, you're already at a successful established recruiting business, you need to understand that like going forward, you have to just simply use more automations in your platform and your basic everyday toolkit. Because if you don't, you're going to sort of be like the recruiter that's still printing out resumes and not using the computer. right? That's literally the difference between someone using AI in 2024 and not using AI to do basic things. It's like someone in 2002 not willing to use the computer because they still want to write like on a typewriter.
Love it.
So yeah, we'll now transition into the Q&A session, and Brian and Sean will begin by answering a couple of burning questions about AI and recruitment that we've already received from some of you all on LinkedIn. But that's not all. We've already received a bunch of questions from you guys, and we've selected quite a few of them, and we'll then move on to answering those questions. All right. A quick disclaimer, as we mentioned earlier, we'll try to answer as many questions as possible. However, if we are not able to answer your questions live, don't get disheartened. We are definitely taking a note of all of your questions and we'll answer those over email. Yeah, all right. So I'll pose the first two questions to Brianna. Here's the first one. How can recruiters effectively balance the use of AI and human touch in recruitment processes?
Balance is important. So here's, I'm going to give you something that might sound heavy, but you really need to do a time audit. What do you spend? Where do you spend your time? How much of it? I recommend doing it for a week. It might feel like, oh my God, why am I doing this? So time, it's time consuming. But once you do it the first time, then you're going to know, where am I wasting time? I think that's what's really key. And then, like Sean talked about before, you're not going to go all in at once. You're going to attack the things that can move the needle the most. Is it sourcing that's taking a long time? Is it coming up with my messaging that's taking a long time? Is it my follow-up that's taking a long time? All of those things. Am I doubting myself? Do I not know how to pitch a company? You know, all of that stuff, or a job. Are my writing job descriptions that doesn't have any DEI in it? Am I spending a lot of time really thinking that through, or could I use technology to do it? So I think that's the good balance. And now I have a lot of people that come through my course and that want to use AI before thinking. You have to have your own thought process first, and then you use AI. I think that's what's really important as well.
All right. Completely agreed. My second question is, what are the ethical considerations and potential regulatory challenges that recruiters must be aware of when implementing AI in their processes, especially in different geographical regions? So this is the second question that we have from the audience.
Yeah,
this is
so
more of an EU question, right, Brianna? Because that folks in across the pond are a lot more hardcore.
Right now, we're only having New York that's giving us a hard time.
Yeah.
It's natural, like when we saw with pay transparency, we saw California and Colorado, like those three states move very quickly to kind of unite on that, and now we see it. So eventually we're going to have lots of, audits and stuff go through. And then per company, it's a thing too. It doesn't even matter what state it is. It's a per company situation. So that one's difficult. So I would just say, it's like, look, you have to check with counsel. You need to stay up on your trends and the laws and stuff, but that's not always easy. I would definitely recommend, a professional on this one. Sean, would you say something else?
In terms of ethical considerations, it's largely around selection, right? Because most of where you use AI for productivity doesn't really have a lot of ethical considerations. It's just helping you get more productive. But the main question around is AI ethical or not is when you give it the power to basically tell you, hey, here's 1,000 applications. Just show me the 50 I need to talk to, and their bias can really play in. And let's say, for the lack of a better word, if there's a certain kind of role that traditionally hires only Asian people or like white folks, and the AI has that data and it's not anonymized, it's likely to like pre-reject candidates that don't make that criteria, even if they're qualified, just because it's trained in a certain way. It says the data, because the data says that a certain minority is more likely to get that job anyway. And that's bad, right? We don't want that. And so those are the sort of things that people need to consider even while implementing AI, especially on the sourcing layer. I think post that, it doesn't it it, it it's there's not really too many ethical problems.
All right, Sean, here's a question for you. What are the possibilities or future applications of AI and recruitment that excite you the most?
So what we're personally excited about the most, if you guys noticed, a week or two ago, OpenAI basically announced that people can go in and build their own GPTs, right? Which is pretty great news. But the two things we're thinking of that we think are going to be really incredible are combining voice and combining conversational GPT on your own data within within any ATS or CRM system you use. So one of the things we at Recruit CRM want to be able to do before the end of 2024, so this is like a big goal for us the next 12 months, is one, give users the option of basically enrolling all of their data into their own GPT model, which will then allow them to converse with that data, where you can basically say, hey, conversation that you can literally type and say, hey, show me candidates that I've spoken to in the last 6 months that have done X. So instead of doing a Boolean search, which you need to learn how to type, you're using natural language text to like talk to your own data. And then layering that up with basic voice technology, where instead of having to type that, you basically open your speaker and you say those words, and you're basically talking to your data, not just for reporting, but literally for day-to-day use. And then you're going from a point and click interface to a speak interface, for the lack of a better word. But yeah, that's what I think is super exciting. And I think it's going to be incredible in the next 4 months.
All right. Thank you guys for answering those questions. We will now move on to answering a couple of questions from the audience. So I've collected a couple of, you know, solid ones. Here's a question for you, Bryna. So Daniel is asking, how can we spot if a candidate uses AI to prepare a resume or even during an interview?
Yeah, it's difficult. So I do know that there's technology being built on from that. I mean, even in schools, right? We're trying to figure out, hey, how does this, is this person using the report? Like, or is there plagiarism? Like, and then is it plagiarism because it's a bot? You know, I know that a lot of companies are doing is they're getting very specific with their questions. So they're really focusing on, here's our culture, missions, and values. Here's what we really believe. And here's why we want this question, not more of the, here's our 50 questions. Now, when someone uses AI to do their resume, I mean, are we upset about that? I wouldn't be upset about that. I mean, we should be using AI to help us with our resumes, our LinkedIn profiles, and all of that stuff. But is it their own words? You know, that's interesting. Here's something that I will tell you, and this is something you have to look out for, is you have to look out for, is the person behind the screen the person also on the paper? Because there's a lot of fraud going on with that, with people taking the interviews for them. And I think that that's what's happening. And then additionally, what's happened to me as well is I had a director of engineering get hired really quickly. And he hooked up some chatbot to Slack to auto respond, you know, and he had two different jobs. So are there things that happen like that? Yes. But what I suggest is not like we don't want to be on the defense all the time. We don't want to just assume the worst. It's like, I think we have to trust first sometimes, unfortunately, and then realize, okay, wait, could I have seen this through their profile? I know with pictures as well, I've been able to identify pictures on LinkedIn that I feel are fake. And so I'm just kind of taking notes of that. And, you know, unfortunately, I don't have like a fast answer to that. It's becoming a little bit of an issue.
Yeah, and you can use tools like GPT-0, or like you can literally just Google tools that help you check if AI was used. But in many cases, I would literally say that if someone's using AI to like apply to your job, the question you need to ask yourself is, can they use AI to do the job? And if they can, then what's the problem? They're probably going to be highly productive.
Yeah.
All right, here's a question for you, Sean. So one of the audience members is asking, what are some of the best ways Recruit CRM has utilized AI to help users so far? Like maybe a couple of examples that we can give.
Yeah, sure. So it's a lot around like what I sort of already showed in the little video. So I think the place where we've used AI the best is around creating resume, or we call them candidate summaries in Recruit CRM. So if you're an actual Recruit CRM user, you can go to help.recruitcrm.io and just write candidate summary or executive search report. So what we've been able to do is we've been able to combine three distinct pieces of technology. The first being our just partnership with TechKernel that lets us parse any CV that you drop in and bring out work and education history. The second is using GPT to take all of that raw text and writing a mini description of who that person is and what they're doing. Combining that with the work history information or educational information or salary information that you've pulled out using AI, and then using our own tech to create like a template, and you can create your own templates, where now you can take all of that text and put it into a template in literally 10 seconds and create a completely new resume based on your format. This is stuff that people would normally do on Adobe. They'd take a resume, they'd open Adobe, they'd put it into it, they'd put their manually put their logo in, they'd have a template. And it would take time. And Luis said, Luis is like, show us out. We actually covered this in this video. So when you get this video in 48 hours, you will be able to see it. You can go back to that part where I was doing the demo and you can sort of see it. The other way we're using using AI is mostly around operational stuff, helping you write a job description, helping you write a helping you write an email, helping you basically just write content that you would manually take more time to write.
All right. Okay. Next question is for you, Brianna. So this is a quite interesting one. How can AI potentially help us attract more client customers? This is asked by Peter.
Ooh, fun. So when you say more, so you said client and customers, that's one and the same, yeah?
Yeah, it says client customers. So I'm assuming he's talking about clients in particular. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So the way I do that, I'd love to share a screen, is actually I do that in ChatGPT. And so for example, let's just say I want to niche down and I want to get all of the SaaS companies. And so I'll ask ChatGPT, I'll say, hey, give me all of the SaaS companies that were also unicorns between 2018 and 2020. And ChatGPT will give me a whole list. And then what I'll do is I'll take that list, and I can also tell them how many companies I want, right? But I'll take that whole list and I'll put it in LinkedIn. I use Recruiter in particular, but you can use Sales Nav and you can also do it one by one. But I do it in Recruiter and I just copy that whole list of all of those SaaS companies. And then I do my outreach for that. And then I know my outreach can be pretty easy with my sequence. I don't have to redo a sequence because I know that they're all SaaS companies and they're all unicorns. And so I'm finding common denominators. And so the way I really acquire clients is for that logic, is to really niche down as much as possible in any different sector so then my message can hit mass amounts of people at once and feel very customized.
Next question is for you, Sean. This is quite a lengthy one. Chris is asking, as recruiters, we need to track our outreaches, messages, conversations, etc. Using LinkedIn sequences to reach out to over 100 candidates, can we integrate those messages with Recruit CRM so that every candidate reached out to automatically creates a profile in Recruit CRM, or do we still have to add them all one by one manually, which takes a long time?
You can. So at this point, we don't have a way to natively do that, as in like we don't have a Recruit CRM to LinkedIn integration. But Recruit CRM integrates with a variety of LinkedIn automation tools like DuckSoup and SourceFill, which were mentioned in the chat. But there's quite a few more, where you can basically if you go on Zapier and you just type in Recruit CRM plus DuckSoup, and maybe if you let me share the screen, Chavi, I can like quickly do a screen share. And this is just one sample, guys. There's like other tools you can use too. It's literally, you can set up an automation that says, add new LinkedIn message from DuckSoup as a note in a candidate in Recruit CRM, or when you get a new connection request, you can basically create automations between LinkedIn automation. So you can say new LinkedIn connection event creates the candidate or a contact in Recruit CRM. So these automations are sort of possible. And again, if you reach out to your account manager at Recruit CRM or even chat support, someone will actually help you set these up.
We'll take one final question. This is for Brianna. Are there any, so James is asking, are there any risks of using automation with LinkedIn? I know that there are quite, they trigger quite happy with people using third-party apps to automate enhance things that can result in LinkedIn jail or expulsion. So, yeah.
Yes, this is something that I also get worried about. So like I did show you like a Dripify or a Wallaxy that I was talking about that uses and does sequences in LinkedIn, although extremely powerful. I personally only use them for a certain period of time. And I also make sure that all the templates that I'm using internally, I have saved also, because at any given moment, sometimes they just acquire companies. They acquire, you know, Connectifier back in the day was that first extension they acquired and got rid of. So I definitely think whenever you're using tools that are not meant, that do not connect, like Sean just showed you, like that they're supposed to. You should always be a little bit nervous about it, for sure. But again, use it in small amounts, and be really mindful that you're really not supposed to. And that LinkedIn, you will get that first thing, that if you're using it too often, or they're seeing that someone's coming into that API, you will get a little thing that says, hey, this, you're not supposed to be sharing your password. This is against our policy. Please click right here that you acknowledge this. If you get that, yes, I would calm that down, because getting kicked off LinkedIn is a really big thing.
Yeah. And to double down on that, right? That's literally one of the reasons why, even though technologically it's super easy, we have a Chrome extension that works on LinkedIn among other apps like Bing and Indeed and so on. While it's super easy for us to create a button that says, hey, scrape all 100 search results and save to the CRM, we don't do that, because the moment you do something like that, the likelihood of you getting flagged by LinkedIn goes up 50x, because then they know it's a bot doing it when you're hitting hundreds of URLs within like 2 or 3 seconds. So we literally physically make you do the painful work of, like, every time you go to a candidate profile, you hit a button and it just saves that one profile, which is not ideal. Like, I don't enjoy it myself, right? But that's the only way you don't go to jail.
Yeah. They will keep you there.
Yeah, and then they keep you there.
All right. So we're done with the Q&A session. Thank you, Brian and Sean, for answering those questions. Kate, if you could reshare your screen, we'll now talk about, you know, something that everybody's been waiting for. It's giveaway time. So, yeah.
Freebie time.
We've got three exciting giveaways planned for all of you, like we mentioned earlier. Okay, all right. So here's what you could win. The first thing is, we have the full cycle tech recruiting course from Thriversity, valued at $1,895. This course is a golden ticket for those aspiring to excel in tech recruitment. It's an in-depth journey into recruitment best practices, focusing on emotional intelligence, sourcing techniques, and so much more. And we'll have one lucky winner for this giveaway. Moving on to the next slide, meet David Rolls, a seasoned recruiter, seasoned business development and recruitment coach, a prolific content creator, and also the host of the David Rolls Experience podcast. David's expertise in the field is unparalleled. David is offering Recruitment 3.0, the modern business development blueprint. This comprehensive course, valued at €999, is specially designed for modern recruiters. It covers everything from securing retained business to creating impactful email sequences and building a formidable personal brand on LinkedIn. We'll also have one lucky winner for this one. Also, the first 20 webinar attendees to email David with the code DavidRolls50 will receive a fantastic 50% discount on this course. So reach out to David at david@davidrolls.uk to seize this opportunity. We are also dropping his email ID in the chat box below, so don't forget to email him the code along with the quick line. Next, we have Cass Van Oort, an innovative recruitment automation expert. Cass is revolutionizing the recruitment industry, unlocking the true potential of AI in talent acquisition. His mission is to help recruiters achieve more with less effort, and his expertise is invaluable for those looking to advance in this field. Cass is offering a free one-hour recruitment consultation. In this session, he will delve into your recruitment processes, offering solutions to enhance efficiency and effectiveness. Whether it's about automating certain tasks, implementing new tools for faster work, or even discovering better candidate sourcing strategies, this consultation is a game changer for your recruitment efforts. The three lucky winners for these three giveaways will be announced on the 11th of December at 10 a.m. PST. We'll be doing a raffle draw to decide who wins. So do keep an eye out on our LinkedIn company page. We'll make a post about the webinar there and declare the giveaway winners in the comments under that post. So best of luck to everyone. All right. Okay. Before we conclude, if you want to explore Recruit CRM and all its AI capabilities, don't hesitate to join us for a quick demo. It's totally free of cost. Our product specialists would love to show you around. The link to book the demo is in the chat box. Also, Brianna's Thriversity is more than just courses. She and her team help create lucrative and thrilling recruitment careers. They are also our preferred recruiter training provider. If you want to check them out, the link for this is also in the chat. Brian and Sean, do you folks have any closing remarks for our audience?
No, I mean, this was super fun.
Yeah, and thanks for spending an hour of your life with us. An hour and a half,
Hour and a
almost.
half. Yeah,
Yeah, we really appreciate it. Yeah.
no, this was super great. Like I said before, like please like let's dig. I really enjoy digging. So it's like if we want more share screens and real world experience and stuff like that, let's continue to do that because I think continuing to helping like it's moving, we move fast, right? And so just one last thing is that again, try one thing at a time. Okay, don't overwhelm yourself because you're not going to adopt it. It takes, I mean, there's tons of data to show it takes 60 to 90 days to create a habit. Okay, so it's like it takes time. You have to see it, you have to test it, just like with your messaging. You're not going to just send one message one day and decide that you gotta, you're going to test it out, right? So same thing with AI.
All right. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you so much, Brian and Sean, for being here today. And thanks, everyone, for joining us again. Have a great day ahead. Cheers.
Thanks for
Cheers,
cruising.
guys.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
All right. Thank
Bye.
you, everyone.
Thank you, Brianna.